In our time of scientific complexity, no one man designs anything. The safest plane, the surest car, the fastest boat is a team affair. You either suffocate in committees and argue into the night, or look for control from a leader. World speed attempts have never prospered from committees, and tradition dictates it takes its lead from the driver. Tony Faheys, already the world's fastest in a prop-driven boat, is spending a quarter of a million of his own money attempting 350 in a jet-driven craft for the overall world water speed record. For almost a year now, he's been gathering his team. Is there one key thing to getting the record?
The people around you. The people that design it, the builders, every part of the people that's involved. If there's a weak link there, then something will go wrong.
The team's that important?
Oh, yeah.
When you first decided about the boat, what sort of things were you taking into account, the actual design of the boat?
Well, the first design we done was in the wind tunnel. It wasn't stable at 350. And then we finished up getting hold of Raj Nandia, who was involved with the Concorde, and he was the only man in the country that had any knowledge of speed on water.
Is he definitely the right man?
Oh, yeah, without a doubt.
Just off the Pembroke Road in Bristol's Clifton, Dr. Raj Nandia, designer of Concorde's leading wing edges, has been busy with his pad. Struggling with the aerodynamics of skimming across water at 350, more used to the flow of wings through air, he'll take the boat from early concept to design. What are your first thoughts when you're landed with a project like this?
I think it sounds very, very difficult to beat a speed like 320 miles an hour. It's got to be very much better than an aircraft in many ways, because it's got to achieve those speeds so close to the water surface.
Do you have to have an idea of what it's going to look like?
Yes, I started thinking about the classical aerodynamic shapes, which is the teardrop shape and aerofoil cross-section. I think I'm going away from that concept and going towards a more triangular Concorde type delta planform, which gives me one sponson in the front and two at the back.
He has in Bristol the entire resources of a specialised university department who cut their teeth on Concorde. But there's very little literature on fast speeds over water, and having got the shape, the initial proving work is with a pencil. A dozen ideas backed by 1,000 equations. After all, E equals mc squared gave us the atom bomb.
I'm an aerodynamicist, and I have learned to live with diagrams like this.
It's hardly romantic, though, D2 and T, L2.
I think the results at the end.
Nobody's ever seen before British pursuit as a three-dimensional object.
Everyone agreed it looked like something out of Star Wars. The final stage of design to Imperial College London and the wind tunnel for a week of tests. It was here that they tested the Bluebirds, both Donald Campbell's car and boat. The major interest centred on ground effect, aircraft speeds still on the ground. The only thing available, a mini rolling road which acts in many ways similar to water. There's not a lot to see in the wind tunnel. The only visual aerodynamic aid is a green dye to make certain the drag forces are even. The initial results are encouraging. A constant change of flow with a constant change of speed. Within the next month, the results will be more carefully sifted. Then over the summer, the really major work begins, the building of the actual boat.
my goodness, there was some action in it. We pick up that action right at the very start. Autumn sunshine over the Lake District greeted 31 starters at the 4th International Windermere Grand Prix. The week before, in the Paris 6 Hours race, the Molinari driver, Cesare Scotti, had lost his life, and some of the works entries had withdrawn from Windermere as a mark of respect. Even so, there were plenty of top names who turned out to do battle here for the £16,000 Duke of York trophy, the richest prize in the sport. Straight into the lead, British national champion Bob Spalding in his Molinari Mercury Twister, followed closely by teammate Tom Percival. World champion Kees van der Velden from Holland started the race as favourite, but within minutes of the start, his Mercury engine gave trouble and Tony Faheys raced past him. What attracted world champion van der Velden to the sport?
Oh, the attraction is, you know, the competition between you and other competitors, and the competition between you and the boat, to keep the boat on the water, between you and the water, you and the wind, you know, all that together make it so, make it so nice, you know. So, how to explain it? It's difficult for me. You know, the competition, only a car race, you only had competition from you and against the other competitors. This is, you had to make more competition between you, water, wind, other competitors, and that's it.
Van der Velden's mechanical trouble continued, and after several pit stops, he finally retired with a burnt-out piston. The champion's retirement led into third place the Cougar Johnson of Bill Badsey and Clive Hook, with its dramatic new air scoop at the stern, giving an added power boost. Lying fourth, Jeff Edwards, number 20, in the Yardley Johnson Scimitar. Behind Edwards, Neil Gregg. He kept close for over an hour, stopped to refuel, then started sinking. Sixth, Steve Pinson in the other Yardley boat. Lap 5, Elf Bullen's Cougar Johnson hits another competitor. The halfway mark. On the interesting Badsey Hook Cougar, the air scoop was giving problems. At speed down the straight, it was working well, but in the turns, when the boat slowed, the engine misfired. As the boat accelerated out of the turn, the engine picked up again and the speed came back. Eventually, the problem was overcome by the drivers accelerating on the turns. Normally a dangerous maneuver, but in this case, it worked. Tony Faheys, number 30, and his Cougar had stopped after the first lap, but now was steadily working his way back up the field in a cloud of spray and sunlight. A pit stop for the race leader, Bob Spalding. A few moments break from the strain of the race. Only seconds separated him from second place man, Percival. About 30 gallons. Blown gasket dashed his hopes, but he managed to nurse a sick engine to finish third. Tony Faheys and his Cougar Johnson showed a rare determination.